Hey folks, today I'm going to show you some of my favorite new features that are part of the next operating system for the Mac, known as Mac OS Ventura. That's coming up next on Tech Talk America. I feel like we need to start by talking about Stage Manager, which Apple is promoting as a whole new way to multitask. When you turn this feature on, which you can access through Control Center, it will move all the applications you are not actively using off to the side. It's basically an alternative to minimizing applications into the dock or using multiple desktops. So let's say I've got my calendar open with Safari, Music, and Final Cut. Stage Manager whisks all but one of them off to the side. If I go into the toolbar, I can find options to have Stage Manager visible at all times, or I can have it only appear when I move my cursor off to the side. In my opinion, I think Stage Manager might be a good idea if you have your Mac hooked up to an ultra-wide display, but if you're using something like a 13-inch MacBook Air, I just don't think you'll find it very useful. Even when Apple presented the demo at WWDC, the example that they gave was a 16-inch MacBook Pro running Final Cut. They then use Stage Manager to drag files from the desktop into Final Cut. But hold on, let's pause that video for a moment. Anyone who uses Final Cut Pro knows you cannot possibly run it in that small a window. I realize a lot of other YouTubers out there are singing the praises of Stage Manager, but I have to be honest with you, I'm not that impressed. So what do you think? Do you anticipate using Stage Manager? Or is this just another one of those features that you'll try once, go, oh, well that's interesting, and then turn it off and never use it again? Let me know your thoughts in the comments section. Now, don't worry, there is good stuff in Ventura. So at this point, let's check out a few of the new features that I think you'll find to be a lot more useful. At this point, let's open up the Photos app. If you look at the sidebar, you'll notice a lock icon next to recently deleted and hidden albums. So to access those albums, you'll need to either enter in your admin password, use Touch ID, or Face ID. Another handy new feature is that photos can now detect duplicate photos. If you look at these two drone photos that I took back in Provincetown, you can see that one is a lot larger of file size than the other. From here, we have two options. I can either delete one of them, or I can merge the characteristics of both into one photo. Personally, I recommend you just delete the smaller of the two images. This next segment was added at the last minute. Just as I was putting the finishing touches on this video, Apple released Beta 3 of Mac OS Ventura, and one of the features that was previously unavailable, I can now show you. That new feature is the ability to create a shared library. While Apple has had shared albums for years, there has never been a way to unify all of the photos that you want to share with the other people that make up your family. To set up this feature, go to Settings and click on the tab for Shared Library. You'll then need to add the other people in your family that you would like to include. It will now ask you how you want to set up your library. You can move all of your photos into that shared library, you can choose based on who is in them or by a certain date, or you can manually set this up. For this demonstration, I'm going to go with manual. I'll now just pick a few photos, and when I'm done, it will ask me if I want to preview the library before sending out the invite. Now that the library is set up, here at the top, I have an option to toggle between either my personal, shared, or see both libraries combined. Another new feature is you can make edits to one photo and then copy and paste those edits to a group of other photos. For this example, I'm going to use this group of pictures I took with my drone. I'm going to double-click on one of them, and let's say I want to see how this looks with the noir filter. Now, I can secondary-click and select Copy Edits. Then I can select the other images in this album, and when I secondary click, I can select Paste Edits. One more cool feature in Photos, in macOS Ventura, you can secondary click on an image, and in addition to copy, there's also an option to copy just the subject. It then gives me an outline showing the boundary of my subject to the background, and now I'll open up a blank pages document, and when I paste the image, you'll see the background has been removed. One of the areas that got a big makeover is System Preferences, which has now been renamed System Settings. As you can see here, this screen more resembles what you would see on iPadOS. Let's explore just a few of the new settings. If we go into Wi-Fi and then click on the Details button next to my network, you'll find that we now have an option to enable load data mode. This is perfect if you're going on something like a cruise ship where you're paying per gigabyte, or if you're using your iPhone as a Wi-Fi hotspot. By turning this on, it will prevent background services from running. You should also know that load data mode will automatically turn off once you join another network. There are a few other settings that I would like to bring to your attention, and many of those are located here under General. If you go into About, it now tells you the exact date that your AppleCare coverage ends. I recommend that you mark that date on your calendar and plan a trip to the Apple Store before, just to get it checked out. That way, if anything is starting to fail, you can get it replaced under warranty. And if you don't live near an Apple Store, you should also know that AppleCare does offer a mail-in option. You just have to ask about it. In the past, if you ever needed to uninstall an app, it was relatively easy, provided that it came from the App Store. But not so easy if you got it elsewhere. Check this out. If we go into Storage and then click on the Inspector icon next to Applications, I can see a full list of every single app on my Mac, regardless of where it came from, and here at the bottom is an option to delete. As someone who works with a lot of people who are new to the Mac, I am well aware that one of the things that can be confusing to a new user is all of the different multi-touch gestures. In all of the previous Mac operating systems, there was a little video that would play so you could see exactly how to perform each multi-touch gesture. As you can see here in Ventura, those videos are gone. So you'll just need to return to my YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe. We have three big changes in Messages. There's actually a lot more than three, but these are the three that I wanted to highlight in this video. You can now edit a message after it's sent. So if you misspell something, you can edit the original message instead of having to send another message explaining that you didn't mean to say ducking. You do know that all you have to do to fix that is to go into text replacement and change it so that every time you type in ducking, it replaces it with. You can only edit a message if you are sending it to a person who is also on an iPhone, iPad, or Mac, and you can only edit it if it's been sent within the last 15 minutes. The second feature is the ability to unsend a message. Again, as long as it's within 15 minutes of sending it, and if the other person is on an iPhone, iPad, or Mac. The third amazing new feature is you can finally mark a message as unread. I have to tell you, I have wanted this feature for years, so I am so thrilled to see that this feature is finally here. At this point, let's switch over to Mail. The first thing I want to show you is one that was not mentioned at the keynote at WWDC. If you secondary click on an email, there is now an option to block the address. So unlike marking it as junk, this will move any future messages from that address directly to the trash. It's not working perfectly right now in beta 2, and one frustration that I have to note is that there's no keyboard shortcut. You have to secondary click and then select block. So fingers crossed they add a shortcut. The big question I think a lot of you will have is, will this do anything for me in terms of reducing junk mail? And the answer is probably not. Junk mail is a really complicated topic, and if you're at the point where it's become totally overwhelming, the best advice that I can give you is to consider booking an hour session with me, and I can show you a solution that has worked exceptionally well for many of my clients. To find out more information, please visit my website at techtalkamerica.com. A couple of other new features in Mail. You can now schedule an email to be sent, and you can also set a reminder to follow up or reply. If you send a message and want to unsend it, you now have that option, provided that you catch it within 10 seconds. One of the new features in Spotlight is you can now use Quick Preview. So let's say I can't tell whether or not this is the file that I'm looking for. If I want to look at it without actually opening it, I can just tap on the spacebar, and if I tap the down arrow, the preview moves to the next item in the list. One of the features that I have mixed feelings about is the Groups tab feature in Safari. In the example that Apple gave at WWDC, they described this as being helpful for planning something like a group trip. Everyone can add their own websites and see everything all in one group. Now, don't get me wrong, I love tools that allow us to collaborate with others, but where I felt this tool was really needed was Maps. I mean, Apple only a few months ago released the new Guides feature, which, by the way, is really amazing. And if you have not checked it out, I did make a tutorial on how to create your own guide. Now, the one and only problem that I have with the guides feature is once you share it with someone else, it does not automatically update. So while I'm glad that you can share Safari tabs, I have to admit, I'm a bit disappointed that we still don't have that feature in Maps. Tell me your thoughts in the comments section. One of the features that I have to mention but can't really demo for you is this new feature called Passkeys. Apple is proposing that this will eventually phase out traditional passwords. It works by reading your biometric data, meaning it either scans your face or reads your fingerprint. There isn't a lot of information yet about the details of how Passkeys works, but trust me, I do have a lot of questions. For example, what exactly does happen when grandma kicks the bucket? Do we have to get out a pair of pliers? Man, this brings a whole new meaning to the term thumb drive. Before we go, some words of wisdom. Anytime Apple comes out with a new operating system, I almost never recommend upgrading on day one. Bugs aren't immediately discovered. That's why I always recommend holding off at least 1 to 2 months before upgrading to a new operating system. Keep in mind, if you ever need help with your Mac, iPhone, or iPad and would like to work with me one-on-one, that is one of the things I do, you can book a one-hour session at my website at techtalkamerica.com. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. This is David A. Cox with Tech Talk America. Class dismissed.